making be placed in a separate part in the record.
Without objection.
Mr. President, I was a college student in town here at Georgetown University, and I can remember it well. You have a lot of time to talk with your roommates about things that you might just do with your life and things that you should do, even as a student. And I remember that week before the March on Selma, there was a serious conversation among my roommates as to whether or not we ought to pack up and head to Selma, Alabama to join in the march. We were serious about it. We thought about it. And in the end, it fell through. Too many classes would be cut and jobs we wouldn't be attending to, and decided at the last minute it just wasn't practical at all for us to do it. I regret that decision to this day. I wish I'd have been there, even if I were in the back of the line, to say I was part of that day in history. It was 56 years ago, last Sunday. Some 600 civil rights activists 56 years ago were kneeling in prayer outside the Brown Chapel AME Church in Selma. Leading them was our dearly departed friend, and I know he was your friend as well, and former colleague John Lewis. As they stood up in the church, they formed two rows and began a silent, orderly march toward Montgomery, Alabama. We all remember that photo of John Lewis coming over that bridge in his tan raincoat and his backpack. As the civil rights activists reached the Edmund Pettus Bridge, they were met by a phalanx of state troopers and armed vigilantes. They wielded cattle prods, billy clubs, shotguns, and other makeshift weapons. And we all know what happened next. Today, that violence is remembered as Bloody Sunday. What some may not know is what happened the night before that march. The county sheriff in Selma, Jim Clark, had issued a call to arms. He ordered white men in the area to join troopers in Selma, and he deputized those people to help stop the march. They answered the call, lining up by the hundreds alongside the state troopers. John Lewis and his fellow patriots were not going to be intimidated. They stood tall. They bore the brunt of racist violence, and they did so with a solemn purpose. They wanted to build a more perfect union in this country, to make sure every voice is heard in our democracy. Days later, with the brutal scenes from Selma fresh in the minds of America, President Lyndon Johnson urged Congress to pass the Voting Rights Act. That August, he signed the bill into law. It's hard to imagine, isn't it? In the same year he proposed it, we actually saw Congress pass a law. That's what happened in the good old days. His law fundamentally changed our republic for the better, but our work remains far from over. Last weekend also marked the anniversary of another tragic moment in our nation's history, far more recent than Bloody Sunday. It was 2 months ago, on January 6th, that a violent mob stormed through the halls of this Capitol building. Like the vigilantes in Selma, they too were answering a call to arms, except this one wasn't issued by a county sheriff. It was issued by the former president of the United States, Donald Trump. The failed insurrection of January 6th not only left five people dead, but like Bloody Sunday, it left a permanent stain on our nation's history. Make no mistake, though more than a half a century stands between these two dark days for democracy, they are part of the same thread that sadly has run through American history: racism. Racism weaponized to deny full citizenship to black and brown Americans. The mob violence that we personally witnessed on January 6th in this building was not an aberration. It was the continuation of a sad chapter in our history. For months, former President Trump had sowed doubt about the legitimacy of the 2020 election. He claimed that widespread voter fraud had allowed Democrats to steal it from him. "Stop the steal," they chanted. We know that President Trump's claims have no basis in reality. Just 2 days ago, the Supreme Court finally dismissed the last remaining case brought by Trump supporters to push the big lie. The Supreme Court didn't buy it. In fact, no court bought it. The former president has never let facts stand in his way, has he? In fact, he claims to know exactly where this supposed voter fraud transpired. Cities like Philadelphia, Atlanta, Milwaukee, and Detroit, coincidentally, cities with large populations of black and brown voters. This is no coincidence. President Trump and his enablers believe they were entitled to victory because they don't think that every American should have an equal vote in our democracy. President Trump's efforts to overturn the election are just the most recent example of a decades-long movement to suppress voters of color. I've spoken on this floor before about investigations I conducted as chairman of the Subcommittee on Civil Rights and Human Rights in Senate Judiciary. I took the show on the road. I traveled to Ohio and Florida, where lawmakers at that time were considering making it more difficult to vote, requiring IDs. And this was before the Supreme Court's disastrous decision in Shelby County. That ruling opened the floodgates. It allowed a number of state legislatures to enact discriminatory restrictions on voting that would no longer require approval from the Department of Justice. That decision was a repudiation of the sacrifice John Lewis and his fellow patriots made on Bloody Sunday. We must learn from our history, whether it was 56 years ago or just 2 months ago, and we must recognize the fundamental right to vote is still under attack. Just last week, the Supreme Court heard arguments in a case that could further fracture the Voting Rights Act by limiting the effectiveness of a provision that allows voters to challenge discriminatory restrictions. And lawmakers in 43 states have already introduced more than 250 bills this year to restrict voting access. Mr. President, this book, One Person, No Vote, was written by Carol Anderson, a professor at Emory University in Atlanta. I read her first book, White Rage, contacted her, and we're friends. I think her analysis of Reconstruction, Jim Crow, the Great Migration, and all that followed is the most lucid presentation I've read about that chapter in history. And in this book, she goes directly into the issue of voter suppression. One of her observations is worth repeating on the floor of the Senate. She refers to what is known in history as the Mississippi Plan. I'll read a few sentences from this book. That became most apparent in 1890 when the Magnolia State passed the Mississippi Plan, a dizzying array of poll taxes, literacy tests, understanding clauses, newfangled voter registration rules, and good character clauses, all intentionally racially discriminatory, but dressed up in the genteel garb of bringing integrity to the voting booth. This feigned legal innocence was legislative genius, evil genius. Virginia Representative Carter Glass, like so many others, swooned at the thought of bringing the Mississippi Plan to his own state, especially after he saw how well it worked. He rushed to champion a bill in the legislature that would eliminate, quote, eliminate the darkie as a political factor in less than 5 years, close quote. Glass, whom President Franklin Roosevelt would one day describe as an unreconstructed rebel, planned not, quote, not to deprive a single white man of the ballot, but to inevitably cut from the existing electorate 4/5 of the Negro voters in Virginia. One delegate questioned him, "Will it not be done by fraud and discrimination?" Glass responded, "By fraud, no. By discrimination, yes. Discrimination, why that is precisely what we propose, to discriminate to the very extreme extremity permissible under the federal Constitution with a view to the elimination of every Negro voter who can be gotten rid of legally without materially impairing the numerical strength of the white electorate. In those days, they were very direct and honest about their ambitions and voter suppression. What is the explanation these days? If we don't believe that there was massive fraud, and there was not by any objective measure in the 2020 election, why are so many legislatures in the business now of reducing the opportunity for Americans to vote in their states? Why? If they can't sell an idea, they just want to change the electorate, and perhaps that will lead to victory. But at what cost? The most enduring legacy of Bloody Sunday is the legislation that helped inspire the Voting Rights Act. We must now draw from this moment in our history a lesson to be realized that the promise of what that legislation, full and vibrant democracy, made up of all Americans of every color and creed, is still an aspiration in this country. We have an obligation not just to restore the Voting Rights Act, but to build on it, to make it stronger and more comprehensive. Fortunately, President Joe Biden's administration is indicating it's ready to do just that. Last Sunday, in honor of the 56th anniversary of Bloody Sunday, President Biden signed an executive order calling on the federal government to make it easier for Americans to register to vote and access the ballot box. While this executive order was a welcome announcement, we need to act as well in Congress. As chair of the Senate Judiciary Committee and a co-sponsor of the John Lewis Voting Rights Act in the last Congress, I look forward to working to restore and strengthen the Voting Rights Act in the months ahead. Though our friend and colleague is no longer with us today, his legacy towers over us. We stand on his shoulders and those of all the American heroes who bled on the streets of Selma in 1965 and long after. We must carry on their fight for equality, and we can begin by enacting a bill the House of Representatives passed last week, the For the People Act. This bill would prohibit voter roll purges, as we've seen in states like Ohio and Georgia, modernize and strengthen voter registration systems and ballot access. I would say to the other party, don't be afraid of the voters. In this democracy, they have the last word, and denying them the right to vote is no way, no strategy for a great political party. It would also help in the dominance of dark money in our political system, including through establishing small donor public financing systems for congressional elections based on my Fair Elections Now Act. The For the People Act is a vital step toward repairing and improving our democratic process. Passing it and the John Lewis Voting Rights Advancement Act will provide critical tools in the fight to ensure that all Americans can exercise their right to vote. These bills represent the bold actions that Americans have been calling for. We must not ignore that call. In 2020, the American people turned out in historic numbers in the election, but they also turned out in historic numbers in protest in support of racial justice across America. John Lewis's March to Montgomery never ended. It's taken on a new life, a new generation of marchers, and more Americans than ever before are putting their feet to the pavement. It's time to finish the work of John Lewis and the heroes of the civil rights movement. As we commemorate the 56th anniversary of Bloody Sunday, we can do no less. With his eyes wide open, John Lewis marched across the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma, knowing he was facing a deadly, hateful crowd. They broke down his body, but they could not defeat his spirit. The question we face today is whether John Lewis's spirit still lives in us. Mr. President, I yield the floor.